So I hope our hearts are made joyous by that act today. I guess announcements, you know, they're all in here, right? And I know you all can read, because half of you are educators, so please read your announcements. I want to thank all of you for your prayers this past week that were lifted up on my behalf. I did test negative twice, though it was the strangest little experience I've had. I did not have a head cold. I did feel a little bit bad on Thursday or Friday. And when I woke up Saturday and had no smell and no taste, I said, uh-oh. So I thought caution was the best, you know, the best plan. So apparently I don't have COVID, which is great news, and I thank you for your prayers. Okay, are there any prayer requests? Alan? Slade was hit by a truck, and we need to pray because now, like you said, his life was altered. Very sorry to hear that. Anybody else have a prayer request? Okay. Well, we've come to worship the Lord. Let's do that, and we'll prepare our hearts now with Karen's prelude. Please rise for confession. Saints, we gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake he forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained servant of the Word of God, and by the authority of Jesus Christ, I declare to you then the entire forgiveness of your sins in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Now, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let's pray. Lord God, govern our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that while keeping the end of all things in mind, we may be stirred up to holiness in this life and and come to be with you forever in the life to come. Grant this, we pray, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
First reading is from Zephaniah chapter 1, 7 through 16. Be silent before the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is near. The Lord has prepared a sacrifice and consecrated his guests. And on the day of the Lord's sacrifice, I will punish the officials and the king's sons and all who array themselves in foreign attire. On that day, I will punish everyone who leaps over the threshold and those who fill their master's house with violence and fraud. On that day, declares the Lord, a cry will be heard from the fish gate, a wail from the second quarter, a loud crash from the hills. Wail, O inhabitants of Mordor, for all the traitors are no more. All who weigh out silver are cut off. At that time, I will search Jerusalem with lamps, and I will punish the men who are complacent, those who say in their hearts, the Lord will not do good, nor will he do ill. Their goods shall be plundered, and their houses laid waste. Though they build houses, they shall not inhabit them. Though they plant vineyards, they shall not drink wine from them. The great day of the Lord is near, near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. The mighty man cries aloud there. A day of wrath is that day, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, a day of trumpet blast and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. Here ends the first reading. The second reading is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 1 through 11. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers, you have no need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief, for you are all children of light, children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So then let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. Here ends the reading.
Thank you. Good morning, boys and girls. Today's story is a familiar story that you've heard at church probably every year or two. And it's a story of parables. The parable is like a story, and it's about talents. Do you have a talent? Maybe you're good in math. You like to read. You're really good at racing trucks up and down the dirt. Things like that. Those are talents that God gives us. Okay?
I'm going to show you what to
check out. Okay, good. That's a talent. Well, the story's about these three servants and his master. And the master was going on a long trip. So he took one of his servants and he gave him 5 talents. And that was a lot of money back then. Okay? So he gave him 5. And he said, you know, you keep this, you take care of it while I'm gone. And he took another servant and he gave him 2 talents. And he told him the same thing. And he took the third servant and gave him 1 talent. That didn't seem quite fair to me when I first read it, but it's just part of the story, okay? So the man's gone for a long time, and he comes back, and he gets the servants, and he says, okay, what did you do? So the guy with the 5 talents said, look, I've got 10 talents now. And that was a bunch of money, okay?
I got 2 servants at home.
Okay, good. So the guy with the 2 talents, he doubled his, and he had 4. That was still a lot of money. The guy with the 1 talent was so afraid that he would lose, because he thought the boss might get mad at him. So he just buried his talents in the ground. But he dug them up, and he brought them back, and he said, here they are, just like you gave them to me.
I'll get them in the dirt.
In the dirt, okay. So the master was very happy with the guy that had the 10 talents, and he was very happy with the guy that had 4 talents. But do you think he was very happy with the one that still had the 1 that he gave him? He was. He got very angry. He told me he was lazy. He said, oh, you're lazy. Why didn't you at least put the money in the bank? Maybe we could have had some interest or something.
So he took the money
from the one that had the 1 talent, and he gave it to the one that had the 10 talents. Okay?
I kept the money in the striped bundle.
Good, yeah. All right, in the parable of the talents, you need to know that God is the master, and we're all the servants. And sometimes we look around and we may think, Miss Karen over there playing that organ, or Miss Karen playing the piano, they got a whole lot more talent than I got. I think I'll just bury my talent. But you know what? God gave them a very good talent, but they also had to practice and work hard for it, didn't they? And it doubled and doubled and doubled, and so they're really good at what they do. If we bury our talent, we're not going to be that good. God wants us to have a purpose. Now, if I showed you this, you would tell me it's a what? Oh, don't worry about the G on the front. I know the new Kirks are not going to like that. What is this right here? Okay? It's a Frisbee, isn't it?
All right.
If I didn't tell you it was a Frisbee and I just handed it to you like this, you might think, I could take that on a picnic and that could be my plate and I could eat off of it.
No.
Or I might could wear it to shade the sun off of me and it'd be a hat.
No, I can't.
Or I could be at the beach and I could dig in the sand with it. That's a pretty good digger. It's pretty tough right there. But you know what? It could be about anything we wanted it to be. But the guy that invented this Frisbee, he invented it so it would what?
Fly.
And if I didn't think I'd knock off a couple of heads, I'd sail it through here, okay? He just invented it to where it would fly. You know, we've got a lot of high-tech things around here that fly, but nothing as good as this. It doesn't require any batteries. We don't have to recharge it or anything. And it can, boy, can it fly and sail around here. So sometimes when we look at the talents that God gave us, we may think, let's bury them, because I want to make sure I just keep that one little thing. But we shouldn't do that. We should live with the purpose that God gives us, okay? God's going to give us a purpose in our life and the talents to go with it, and we've got to make sure we use it for what God wanted us to, okay? All right, let us pray. Y'all, congregation too, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gifts you've given each of us. We pray that you will be faithful in using all these gifts to show others how wonderful you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, boys and girls, get your bulletin, okay?
Gospel is from St. Matthew, the 25th chapter, beginning at verse 14.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus is speaking to us about what it will be like when he returns. For it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted to them his property. To one he gave 5 talents. to another two, to another one, each according to his ability. Then he went away. He who had received the five talents went at once and traded with them, and he made five talents more. So also he who had the two talents made two talents more. But he who had received the one talent went and dug in the ground and hid his master's money. Now after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. And he who had received the five talents came forward, bringing five talents more, saying, Master, you delivered to me five talents. Here, I have made five talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. And he also who had the two talents came forward, saying, Master, you delivered to me two talents. Here, I have made two talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. He also who had received the one talent came forward, saying, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours. But his master answered him, You wicked and slothful servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown, and gather where I scattered no seed? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and at my coming I should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he is will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And this is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Okay, dear saints, does that parable thrill you or scare you? Well, Sir Michael Costa was a celebrated conductor of the 19th century, and he was holding a rehearsal with a great orchestra and a great chorus, and as the choir sang flawlessly and the music built and built to the crescendo, and all the different instruments were playing along, and you can just kind of hear that in your head growing and growing and growing. Well, the piccolo player, and that's the teeny little flute, right? Thinking perhaps that his contribution wouldn't be heard in all of that sound, decided he wouldn't play anymore, and he stopped playing. Suddenly, the great leader stopped and cried out, Where is the piccolo? The sound of that one small instrument was necessary to complete the fullness of the piece as the composer had written it. And small as it was, it played at a pitch and gave a tone that no other instrument could give. And the conductor knew that. So when it dropped out, he heard it, or lack of it, and therefore stopped the practice. The piccolo player thought his contribution was insignificant in the orchestra. Sometimes the smallest and seemingly less important one can make the greatest contribution. And even if it doesn't seem to make that big a difference to the audience at large as they're listening to the symphony, guess what? The conductor knows when you stop playing. Today's parable of the talents, and of course, in the parable itself, the talents literally mean bags of gold, because what we're talking about here in today's terms would be hundreds of thousands of dollars that the master is giving these people. Today, in the parable of the talents, we are reminded that God is deeply interested in our lives and what we do with them. And of course he is. He's the conductor. He's the master of the symphony. And he has given us our lives as a gift, right? We all know that. And just as in the parable, then he lays a charge on us to do something with our lives, to increase the gift and to add to the glory of God. You see, God is in the business of giving life. Life that in turn makes more life. That's what happens in nature, right? God created life, and then it creates more life, which then creates more life, and that life just keeps going on, and God's in the midst of all of that, making more and more and more. That's why the Bible is so pro-family and pro-child, by the way. God is the giver of life. And God gives blessings that in turn create other blessings. Take, for example, Father Abraham. He says to him, I'm going to bless you and make you a great nation, and all the nations of the world will be blessed through you. It's kind of like that principle of life. Blessings then create blessings, which create blessings, which create blessings. And God grants us opportunities that, if seized and acted upon, can in turn enlarge the opportunities for others. Robert Young was a successful businessman in Seattle who went on a business trip into New Mexico, and he noticed in the newspaper, local newspaper there, a headline that read, Elders freeze to death. The news article detailed the crushing poverty of the local Native American reservation and the horrible living conditions that many of the elderly Indian people were living in. And the news story grabbed his heart. And when he learned from the story of an adopt-a-grandparent program for Native American elders, he called the number and signed himself up. And Robert was paired with a 78-year-old Native American woman in South Dakota named Catherine Redfeather. So they began a correspondence, and Catherine welcomed Robert into her family and actually began calling him her newest grandchild. And in spite of her poverty, her letters to him were full of joy as she proudly shared news of her large family. When Robert asked Catherine if there was anything he could send her, she asked only for a bottle of shampoo and some aspirins. And Robert couldn't imagine living in such poverty that shampoo and aspirin were considered a luxury item. So he and his wife decided they needed to visit Catherine to see what else they could do. And so they went to the reservation. They were shocked by the poverty they saw, but they were humbled by the love and the joy of Catherine and her family. Now, when he returned home, Robert found that he no longer could be quite satisfied in the work he was doing as a businessman. And he was worrying all the time if his adopted grandmother was safe and warm and had all she needed, as well as other elders on the reservation. So that summer, Robert, his wife Anita, and a handful of friends traveled back to South Dakota to build a house for Catherine. As news of their project spread on the reservation, Catherine's family and friends all showed up to help, and they had a big celebration when the house was complete. Well, now Robert could relax and get back to his ambitious and successful life, right? No. God had put a new vision in Robert Young's heart, and he couldn't bury his talent, if you will, in self-interested pursuits. So after a lot of research, prayer, and thought, Robert Young sold half of his successful business, or his half of the business, I should say, and he and his wife, Anita, moved to Bozeman, Montana, and started the Red Feather Development Group, which to this day provides affordable housing to Native Americans. He was blessed, and he knew it. And when he saw the need, he knew what he needed to do. He needed to bless in return. See, that's how God operates. That's a godly principle. Life begets life. Blessings need to be passed along as blessings, and opportunities that God gives us need to create new opportunities for those around us. It's important that we understand that so that we can understand verse 29. Now, let me read verse 29, because I know when it was read, it went over the top of our heads. And actually, it's the point of the parable, the way the parable is written. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken away from them. And I remind you that the context of that is spoken about the end of time when the day of judgment comes. So that's a big thing. That's a big deal. Those who have, in other words, those who know and who own the life and the blessing and the opportunity that God gives, those kind of people live in such a way that they create more life, pass along blessings, right? Create more opportunities for other people. And that pleases God. Of course it does, because God is a God of vibrant and dynamic life. But those who ignore this, those who can't see the blessings of God in life, who simply fear God or even despise their life or despise God, those who, as the parable says, bury their bag of gold in the ground, they miss the opportunities God gives to increase the blessing, and they tend to go nowhere in life, and worse yet, on the day of judgment, they risk losing it all. So what about your life? And what about the communal life of this congregation? Are you and are we investing time and talent, our abilities, our money, our life energy into the projects that God gives us, into the people that God sends around us, right? Into the needs which we see right before us? Are we investing ourselves to be a blessing to others? Now, you and I both know that if you do that, if you go out and take those five talents and try to turn them into five more, that's a lot of hard work. And you have to take risk on. You might actually fail in trying. And you might end up with a broken heart in a relationship, or bankruptcy when the business fails, or even public ridicule for trying something that no one's ever tried before. But remember, the great master of life, the great conductor of the symphony, he knows the value of each piccolo, right? And when the piccolo gives up and stops trying, he hears it. So by all means, don't give up. And don't stop trying. Keep investing your life. The difference between the two servants who doubled their blessing given them by the master and the one servant who buried his blessing is the difference really between faith and fear. See, all three were entrusted. I love that word, entrusted. God gave a trust to them. God trusted them and gave them that blessing. And with that blessing, of course, came great responsibility, and that can be a very scary thing, but it also created a great opportunity. Wow, they're servants, and now here's $100,000. Go do something with it. And they know that the master, who's very wealthy, is also very generous. He's giving them this money, and some of that will be accrued to them. What a blessing. And they saw that great opportunity. And so they, in turn, trusted the master's trust in them. Does that make sense? They trusted the master's trust in them. He had seen the talent he had put into those servants and knew they could do it, and he gave them that gift to make it so. And so they trusted the master's trust in them. They seized the opportunity, and they enlarged the blessing. And that's how Jesus wants his disciples to live their lives between now and his return, or most likely between now and when we die, right? Trusting God, increasing the blessing, investing our lives into others. But that other fellow who lived fearful of God, ignoring the blessing and opportunity, who did nothing with his life, God have mercy on his soul in the day of judgment. So what kind of servant are you? And what kind of servant, church, are we? I hope, again, when you read that parable, does it thrill you or does it scare you? I hope it thrills you, because we serve a very wealthy master who knows how to give great blessings, and he invites us to enter the joy of those blessings here in this life and in the life to come. Amen. Let us pray. Oh, gracious Father, we thank you for our lives and all the talents and gifts you've given us. And we pray, oh Lord, that you would give us faith. Faith that trusts you, Lord, and the trust you've put in us, so that we can indeed invest our lives, oh Lord, to making this world a better place and to helping others along the way. Help us do that this week, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, now we sing, "Forth in thy name, O Lord, I go."
Thank you.
confess our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In our prayers today, we are going to pray, of course, for Billy Phillips, who was hit by the truck. We want to continue to pray for our brother, George. George has been able to come home, but he's really miserable right now. It's hard on him, and so it's a long recovery, so we want to keep praying him to the Lord. We also want to pray, and I know most of you have never met this man, but he's a member of the congregation, Charles DeSalvo. I think he's 85. They came down from Wisconsin, and let us pray to God, the Master of all, that we may serve God with eager devotion, using our time, talent, and treasure for the good of his kingdom and the well-being of others. Oh, in your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. That we may invest our lives into the lives of others and help them to know the Master. In your mercy, Lord,
hear our prayer.
That we may prepare ourselves for the day of judgment by living alert and self-controlled lives, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. In your mercy, Lord,
hear our prayer.
That we may be preserved from political violence and live as people of peace. In your mercy, Lord,
hear our prayer.
That we may remain faithful in prayer as we battle the spiritual forces of wickedness, and that we may be preserved from all temptation and evil. In your mercy, Lord,
hear
us, O God, as we pray for country and government and our civil discourse together, that we may be righteous and truthful and put away all falsehood and selfishness. In your mercy, Lord, hear us, O God, as we search for a youth director. You are the Master who gives abilities and talent in accordance with your gracious will. Send us that person whom you know will invest their talents in helping us build our youth ministry and whose abilities match our many needs. In your mercy, Lord, hear us, O God, for Lake Wiley Lutheran Church in Fort Mill, South Carolina. Bless the leadership of Pastor Craig Abey and Preschool Director Danielle Hawkins, and continue to use their school to be a blessing to the children of their community. In your mercy, Lord, hear us, O God, as we begin our preparations for the Thanksgiving holiday in our families. As we gather together, help our hearts to take time to truly count our blessings, to discern the many ways your loving presence is with us throughout the year, and to renew our family love and care for one another. In your mercy, Lord, hear us, O God, for those in this congregation who are struggling with health problems, but especially we pray for George that you would continue to strengthen his body and heal his leg. And for Mr. Charles, Lord, we pray that he would rally and that he would regain his strength, that he might continue on to be a blessing in his family. And hear our prayer, O Lord, for Billy Phillips. How hard this must be for him, having been hit by this truck and severely damaged by this. So we pray, Lord, for your healing power and your perfect presence to be in his life. And not only in his life, Lord, but in the lives of those who love him. Grant them, O Lord, courage and strength and faith to put their trust in you at this time. In your mercy, Lord.
Hear our prayer.
O God, hear our prayer for all loved ones, friends, and families who are struggling with health problems. Take them into your divine care and heal them in accordance with your gracious will. And hear us now as we name them before you. Lord, in your mercy. O God, Master of all that is and ever will be, let our participation in the Holy Sacrament so fill our hearts and minds with your grace and peace that we desire nothing more in the week ahead than to be your willing servants in all we think, say, and do. In your mercy, Lord. Now into your hands we commend our prayers, spoken and unspoken, imploring your merciful help through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. At this time, we take up the offering. Let us pray. Merciful Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed a joy and for our good benefit that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death in the grave and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Then after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you.
body of Christ for you. The body of Christ. The body of Christ for you. The body of Christ for you. The Lord Jesus bless you. The Lord Jesus bless you. The body of Christ for 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 you.
body and blood of our Lord, preserving the true faith unto life everlasting, depart in his peace.
Amen.
Saving grace, that using the talents you have given us, we may work tirelessly as your willing servants. Amen. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.